Hi everyone, Ashley here and welcome to another video on my YouTube channel. Today I am super excited to be sharing another card that I made as part of my guest designer posting at the latest Lawn Fawnatics challenge, which was to create a scene. And if you don't know what Lawn Fawnatics is, it's basically a challenge that runs every few weeks with a different theme or idea that kind of gives you inspiration into a different card to make. So this current challenge is called Create a Scene, and really the idea is just to create a scene using Lawn Fawn Supplies, of course. And Lawn Fawn Supplies are, of course, if you've watched any of my videos or any of them at all, really, you'll know that Lawn Fawn is one of my favorite companies to create with. I just love their products. They're so cute. So to create a scene with Lawn Fawn products was, for me, a very natural challenge because it's something that I do a lot in card making. Creating scenes is one of my favorite things, and of course using Lawn Fawn is one of my favorite things. So I was so honored and excited to be asked to be a guest designer for this challenge and to show off some different scenes using Lawn Fawn products. So I'm so excited to be here, and I'm really excited to share this with you. So as I was talking about the Lawn Fawnatics challenge, you saw me blending a watery background. I cut out a piece of Strathmore Bristol Smooth cardstock with the large Slimline rectangle die by Lawn Fawn, and I blended on three different colors of Distress Oxide ink for that. I used Blueprint Sketch as the darkest blue, then Peacock Feathers in the middle, and then Tumbled Glass on the top as the lightest. Here I have a piece of the same cardstock, so Strathmore Bristol Smooth, which I'm coloring as sand. And for that I used Scattered Straw as the lightest yellow and Brushed Corduroy as the darker color. And then I'm just splattering it with a little bit of Brushed Corduroy that I diluted in water, just to give a little bit of extra dimension. And by the way, that piece was cut with the Slimline Stitched Hillside Border Die by Lawn Fawn as well. Next, I'm bringing back my water piece because I wanted to add some bubbles. So for this, I'm pulling up my Bubble Stencil, which was a new stencil released lately by Lawn Fawn. It was part of their Spring 2021 release. And I'm just sort of tacking it down in different places in the background and along the whole panel and using different sized bubbles as I go. So sometimes I'm choosing the largest one, sometimes the middle one, and so on. And for each of the openings, I'm just sort of placing it down, holding it with my fingers, and if I need to, I'm masking off bubbles around it with some blue tape just to make sure I don't get any stray ink. And then what I'm doing is I'm taking Peacock Feathers and Tumbled Glass ink and just inking a little bit on with my blending brushes. And if you remember, those two colors are the colors I actually used for the background itself. So this is generating a really tone-on-tone, sort of subtle bubble look because I'm using the same colors for the bubbles that I used for the background. And that's exactly what I wanted because, of course, this is an underwater scene. So these bubbles are meant to just look like more water, similar to what is around them. So it's just bubbles of water within water, or I guess bubbles of air within water, see-through so you can see the water. I don't know if that makes sense, but what I'm trying to say is that I really wanted it to be very subtle and the colors to really match the water that was already blended. So it's nice that when you blend it on through the stencil, you still see the effect of the bubbles because even though it's tone on tone, it still creates that circular shape. Now, the stencil set also has these little sort of bubble light patterns, I guess, light touches. I don't know what those things are called, but I'm using some Scattered Straw, so just some light yellow Distress Oxide ink, and blending through that onto each of the bigger bubbles so that you get that little sort of shiny edge. And I thought that was a really nice way to do it. Okay, so I've put that aside to sort of dry up, and as I'm doing that, I'm now going to go ahead and stamp out all of the images that I'm using on this card. I will admit I used a lot of different images. I stamped out a lot of different images, I should say, and I don't end up using them all, but what I like to do when I'm making big scenes like this is to sort of just stamp out whatever I think I may need, because I really don't like the idea of being left at the end having stamped and colored everything and cut everything and then realizing I need something else and having to go back to the stamping phase. So I like to get all of my stamping out of the way at once. So I stamp like crazy, and then at the end of the day, if not all the images fit on the card, which spoiler alert, in this case they don't, I just keep those images for a future card. So I'm using Lawn Fawn Jet Black ink and my mini Misty tool to stamp out these images onto some Neenah Solar White paper. And I'm just stamping them all out twice to make sure I get a nice black crisp image. Okay, so I didn't show the stamping for every single image, but I think you get the idea. So I'm gonna go ahead and continue with the coloring. And again, for the coloring, I'm also not going to show the coloring of every single image here because I think after a little while you'll get the idea, but I am going to show you how I colored these bubbles because the bubbles are a newer product from Lawn Fawn. They were also part of the latest spring 2021 release, and I think everyone right now is sort of interested in coloring these bubbles and excited about coloring these bubbles. And there are so many different techniques you can use for these bubbles. I've seen all kinds of different ways to color them in, and honestly, nothing is wrong. Any way that you want to color these bubbles is going to be good. And you can really just kind of try out different things. I don't think I've ever done a card where I color these bubbles the same way twice. So every card I've made with these bubbles has them colored slightly differently. And I think that's part of the fun of them, is really just experimenting and trying to figure out which way of coloring them you like the best. By the way, you'll notice my cat Luna likes to join me in these videos. She often just walks back and forth across the screen, which in real life translates to her just walking back and forth across my face so I can barely see what I'm doing, and she just likes to sort of have some head nuzzles and cuddles as I'm coloring. So you'll often see her kind of walking back and forth on the screen. So for these bubbles, what I'm doing is I'm coloring them in with a mixture of very, very light blue and very, very light yellow. And I'm just going around the very edge of the bubble with each color about halfway. So I colored around about half of the edge of the bubble with blue, and then I'm coming in to finish the bubble edge with yellow. So whatever I don't color blue, I'm coloring with yellow. And it's very hard to see on the camera. It's a lot easier to see in real life, but what it ends up being is that each bubble has a very faint inner outline of blue and yellow. And I just thought those colors were nice for underwater bubbles because it's sort of like the blue is reflecting the color of the water, and maybe the yellow is reflecting the color of sort of the sunlight coming in. So I just thought that would work nicely with water bubbles. And I really do like how it turned out in the end. So I encourage you to try that as a technique that you may want to try, especially if you're coloring bubbles underwater. Or coloring bubbles for underwater. I don't know if you'd want to be underwater while coloring the bubbles. So now I'm moving on to coloring some of the rest of these sort of underwater elements. And like I said, I'm not going to show the coloring of every image that goes onto this card, but I did want to show a few just to kind of give you an idea of how I colored them. I chose some really bright rainbow colors for this because I like to do that a lot for underwater cards where I just find there's so much natural color in underwater elements in real life. Lots of like underwater vegetation and plants and animals and everything underwater seems to have a lot of color to it, so I really like to represent that in my underwater-themed cards. So I chose, for each of these images, I chose a set of two colors, a light and a dark shade, because the images are quite small. So in this case, I found that I didn't need any more than that. And if I did feel like I needed more dimension, it's very easy to go back in with your dark shade after you've blended and kind of add an extra layer of dark. And I find that adds almost like a faux layer of dimension if you need it. And you'll see me doing that here for this octopus. So for this octopus, I'm coloring it in orange, and I'm using my darker shade here and putting it down in areas where I think that there would be more shadow. So trying to avoid the areas where I think the light would hit. And I'm just going around onto all of its tentacles and adding in that shadow. And I also did an outline sort of around its head as well. Then I'll come in with the lighter shade. And by the way, for this octopus, my Copic colors were Y38 as the darker shade and Y35 as the lighter shade. And I'm just blending out all the areas where I put the darker shade. So just going tentacle by tentacle and blending where I put the darker shade with the lighter shade. Just kind of overlapping it a little bit until I get a nice blend. Then I can come back to the head area and do the same thing. And I'm just kind of coming in a circular motion. And what I'm going to end up doing is bringing in a yellow shade to finish off the head. Now, I didn't end up liking this. I thought that there wasn't enough sort of blending between the orange and the yellow. So what you'll see on the final card is that the whole head is just orange. So eventually I do come back and just overlay the whole thing with the light orange, and I end up liking that better. So now I'm doing that thing that I mentioned before, where I'm coming back in with the darker shade once more and just adding an extra layer of it into those dark areas of shadow. And that just sort of helps emphasize those areas of shadow and kind of creates almost like a third layer of dimension, even though you only used two different shades. So that's a really good way to get extra dimension if you need it. Okay, and the last image that I'm going to show coloring here is just this smaller octopus. And for this one, I chose to color it with green, and I'm using much of the same technique here. So I'm going around first with the darker green shade, just going sort of around the edge of the head and then in all the areas where I think there would be shading on the tentacles. Then I can come in with the lighter green, go through all the tentacles again, and blend out that dark color with the light color. Finally, I'm coming back in with the dark shade one last time and adding an extra layer just to add that almost faux third layer of darkness. And it really does add quite a lot of dimension. So I do that on a lot of my colored images. Okay, so like I said, I finished the rest of the images off camera and I did cut them out as well. So that's why you can see them scattered all around. And to continue working on this card, I'm just blending out a panel with some orange, wild honey, and yellow, scattered straw, distress ink. And I'm going to use this panel to cut out the word birthday using the Lawn Fawn Scripty birthday die. And I just kind of wanted it to have that bright pop of orange color. Okay, now I can start to assemble the card. So I took my sand piece and just added some liquid glue onto the back, and then I can stick it straight down onto the water. Then it's time to start actually assembling the scene. So I'm going to show quite a bit of footage of me setting the scene up, just so you can kind of get an idea of how I like to do it when there's so many different elements going on. So what I typically like to do when I'm building complex scenes is to kind of lay out the images first, and don't glue anything down yet. And just kind of get an idea of where you like things to be, what you like the placement as, where you want the different elements to go, and so on. After I've done that, what I usually do is I take a picture, and I have that on my phone, and I put it off to the side, and then it's time to sort of start adhering everything. So at that point, usually I have to clear everything off, but it's okay because I have the picture. And then I can start sort of gluing everything down one by one, starting with that background piece. So in this case, I cleared everything off and then glued the sand down, and then I can kind of start coming back in with each image one by one and sticking it down. And usually what I like to do with these scenes is I like to vary what's on foam squares and what's just glued down to the scene flat. So in this case, I am generally sticking some of sort of the more main images up onto foam squares. So that octopus is stuck onto foam squares. Both octopi, I guess, are stuck onto foam squares. The cake is on a foam square. The present, basically any of the aquatic creatures are on foam squares so that they stick out and there's emphasis on them. And then some of the sort of more background images, so a lot of the bubbles, some of the sort of vegetation, things like that, are just glued straight down to the panel flat. So they kind of fade a little bit more into the background. So I'm just kind of going through one by one and sticking things down where I know that I want them to be based on that sort of picture that I took, and then just kind of building the scene as I go. For a lot of these images, you'll notice that I stuck little bubble wands in their hands, which I just thought this idea of underwater critters blowing bubbles was really cute. So I used some liquid glue to do that, and then I can just stick the whole image down on foam once everything is sort of glued into pieces. And when I am gluing things down, I tend to use my craft tweezers to kind of get that perfect placement so that your fingers don't get in the way, and I like to use multimedia matte as my liquid glue of choice for these little images especially because it is a matte glue, so if you do squeeze a little bit extra and a little bit kind of comes out of the sides, you're not going to see it because it's matte. It really just blends into the background, which is nice. Now I went ahead and scattered a whole bunch of bubbles into the water, and I'm just kind of gluing them down one by one with liquid glue, the same way I glue down the rest of the images. For the word birthday, I'm again just using that Tim Holtz multimedia matte glue and just kind of squirting a little bit onto the back, just holding it down with my fingers to make sure the whole piece sticks down properly. By the way, off camera I did go ahead and cut out a wavy banner from Pearlescent Vellum, which is a really beautiful iridescent vellum, and I stamped the word happy onto it from another Lawn Fawn stamp set, and that's what you see there above the word birthday. I glued down that pearlescent vellum straight to the panel using some liquid glue and then put the word birthday right on top. One of the final finishing touches on this card is to add little party hats to a bunch of the little critters. So for each of these, I did just stick a little foam square on them so that they're elevated at the same height as the critter, and then glued them onto the critter's head, I guess, with some liquid glue as well, just to make sure everything is stuck together nicely. And after I finish this, the card is almost complete. I am going ahead and adding in just a couple more elements. I'm adding this little party, I don't even know what you'd call that, that little thing that you blow in to make noise for parties, into the octopus's tentacle, and then adding just a couple little more rocks along the scene as well. One of my problems usually is that I don't know when to stop, so I just keep adding and adding it until there's way too much on the card. I might have done this here, I'm not sure. So finally, I'm just taking the whole panel and gluing it down onto a card base. This is, of course, a Slimline card, so it measures 8.5 by 3.5 inches. And that is the final card. That is it. Of course, I could have kept going. I was really tempted to add more sparkle or more images, but I think it's fine as it is, and I left it this way. So I really love all the dimension that you get from adding the foam onto the back of a lot of these images, which I'm trying to show you by sort of turning the card, as well as that really nice subtle bubble effect you get in the background from that wonderful stencil. So that's it. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that this video gave you some inspiration on what to do with these images and how to create a scene using Lawn Fawn supplies. Again, thank you, Lawn Fawnatics, for having me as a guest designer. I had so much fun. And I'll see you all in the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye!